Why did Jesus come? What is the purpose of his mission? Today, we're going to be looking to answer just that question. Jesus stated his purpose several times, and our aim here is to examine them so that we can fully understand why he came. We are trying to be exhaustive with this list of verses, and all verses are listed in context. Let us go through the canonical Gospels and extract all of Jesus' statements of purpose. 1. That the world be saved. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. 2. To fulfill the prophecy of Isaiah 61, verses 1 and 2. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. And he closed the book, and he gave it again to the minister, and sat down. And the eyes of all them that were in the synagogue were fastened on him. And he began to say unto them, This day is this scripture fulfilled in your ears. 3. To preach the kingdom of God. And when it was day, he departed and went into a desert place. And the people sought him, and came unto him, and stayed him, that he should not depart from them. And he said unto them, I must preach the kingdom of God to other cities also, for therefore am I sent. And he preached in the synagogues of Galilee. 4. To call sinners to repentance. When Jesus heard it, he saith unto them, They that are whole have no need of the physician, but they that are sick, I came not to call the righteous, but the sinners to repentance. 5. To do the will of the Father. And Jesus said unto them, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger, and he that believeth on me shall never thirst. But I said unto you, that ye also have seen me, and believe not. All that the Father giveth me shall come to me, and him that cometh to me I will in no wise cast out. For I came down from heaven, not to do mine own will, but the will of him that sent me. And this is the Father's will which hath sent me, that all of which he hath given me I should lose nothing, but should raise it again at the last day. And this is the will of him that sent me, that every one which seeth the Son, and believeth on him, may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up at the last day. 6. To throw fire on earth, and 7. To give division to earth. I am come to send fire on the earth, and what will I if it already be kindled? But I have a baptism to be baptized with, and how am I straitened till it is accomplished? Suppose ye that I am come to give peace on earth? I tell you, nay, but rather division. For from henceforth there shall be 5 in one house divided, 3 against 2, and 2 against 3. The father shall be divided against the son, and the son against the father, the mother against the daughter, and the daughter against the mother, the mother-in-law against her daughter-in-law, and the daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. 8. For judgment, in order that those not seeing may see, those seeing may become blind. Jesus heard that they had cast him out, and when he had found them, he said unto them, Dost thou believe on the Son of God? He answered and said, Who is he, Lord, that I might believe on him? And Jesus said unto him, Thou hast both seen him, and it is he that talketh with thee. And he said, Lord, I believe. And he worshipped. And Jesus said, For judgment I am come into this world, that they which see might not see, and they that which see might be made blind. 9. That they may have life and have it abundantly. Then said Jesus unto them again, Verily, verily, I say unto you, I am the door of the sheep. All that ever came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. I am the door. By me if any man enter in, he shall be saved, and shall go in and out and find pasture. The thief cometh not, but for to steal, and to kill, and to destroy. I am come that they might have life, and that they might have it more abundantly. 10. To serve, and 11. To give his life a ransom for many. And when the 10 heard it, they were moved with indignation against the two brethren. But Jesus called them unto him, and said, Ye know that the princes of the Gentiles exercise dominion over them, and they that are great exercise authority upon them. But it shall not be so among you. But whosoever will be great among you, let him be your minister, and whosoever will be chief among you, let him be your servant. Even as the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister, and to give his life a ransom for many. 12. To seek and deliver the perished. And Zacchaeus stood, and said unto the Lord, Behold, Lord, the half of my goods I give to the poor, and if I have taken anything from any man by false accusation, I restore him fourfold. And Jesus said unto him, This day is salvation come to this house, for so much as he also is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which was lost. 13, to save the world. Jesus cried and said, He that believeth on me, believeth not on me, but on him that sent me. And he that seeth him that sent me. I am come a light into the world, that whosoever believeth on me should not abide in darkness. And if any man hear my words, and believe not, I judge him not. For I came not to judge the world, but to save the world. 14. To be a witness to the truth. Pilate said, Am I a Jew? Thine own nation and chief priests have delivered thee unto me. What hast thou done? Jesus answered, My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, then I would my servants fight, that I should not be delivered to the Jews, but now is my kingdom not from hence. Pilate therefore said unto him, Art thou a king then? Jesus answered, Thou sayest I am a king. To this end I was born, and for this cause came I into the world, that I should bear witness unto the truth. Everyone that is of the truth heareth my voice. So, we see that Jesus came for a variety of reasons. Now that we have this list, we can combine these where they are essentially the same in order to find a single statement of purpose that will include the most fundamental and basic statement of the purpose of Jesus' coming. Numbers 1, 12, and 13 are essentially the same thing. Jesus came, therefore, to save the world. We combine these three statements into number 1. We also see that number 9 is similar in context. We see this in relation to where Jesus said, For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Thus, if they have eternal life, then they are being saved from perishing. And so we can also combine number 9 with number 1. Number 10 does not represent a statement of basic purpose. It was given in a context where Jesus uses himself as an example to the disciples that are thinking in terms of being served rather than serving. We can therefore remove it. Numbers 6 and 7 are from a statement given in response to a rhetorical question. The prophets had long since promised peace on earth, and most Jews connected this peace with the advent of the Messiah. But Jesus knew that it was not going to happen. So he asked them, Suppose ye that I am come to give peace on earth? This response does not speak of the promise of his coming, but of a result of his coming that would be contrary to what the Jews expected. Therefore, we can remove these also. The statement of purpose relating to Isaiah 61 is interesting. To fulfill the prophecy of Isaiah 61. This cannot be a basic statement of purpose. If Jesus came only to fulfill prophecy, then why bother? Simply for the goal of fulfilling prophecy? No. But the purposes are indicated in the details of the prophecy. These are important to note, but due to the indirect manner of this statement, we will set this aside and look at it later. Thus, we are left with only 7 statements. Jesus came, therefore, to save the world, to preach the kingdom of God, to call sinners to repentance, to do the will of the Father, for judgment in order that those not seeing may see, those seeing may become blind, to give his life a ransom for many, and to be a witness to the truth. Next, to speed along the process, is to show what we have learned is the basic and fundamental purpose for his coming, then show how the remainder are derivatives. Jesus did not come by his own will. God sent him, and Jesus stated this very conclusively, saying, Ye both know me, and ye know whence I am, and I am not come of myself, but he that sent me is true, whom ye know not. But I know him, for I am from him, and he hath sent me. But I have greater witness than that of John. For the works which the Father hath given me to finish, the same works that I do, bear witness of me, that the Father hath sent me. And the Father himself, which hath sent me, hath borne witness of me. Ye have neither heard his voice at any time, nor seen his shape. For I came down from heaven, not to do my own will, but the will of him that sent me. Jesus' basic purpose in coming into the world must be to fulfill the purpose that the Father gave him when he sent Jesus. As stated in John 6:38, Jesus didn't come to do his own will, but that of the one who sent him. This is number 4 in our list, to do the will of the Father. This is the basic statement for God's purpose in sending Jesus, and therefore the purpose of his coming. Thus, we need to define the will of God and show that the other statements in the above list are secondary statements of purpose, and therefore secondary statements of God's will. Let us start by summarizing the will of God. God is a spiritual father that loves his children. But the children are in love with the world where they abide in the flesh and do not care for the Father. Instead, they find identities with the earthly, carnal fathers that begot them according to the flesh. God knows that this bond of flesh must be broken before the children of the flesh are free to seek the spiritual parent. Until then, these children are both lost and dead to him. God is in heaven, and his one will for his children is that they learn to love him, and out of that love, put the flesh and love of the world away from themselves and arise to him. These children of the flesh are not wholly carnal. They have a vacuum in their hearts that can only be filled by God in heaven. In their ignorance, they devise many gods and religions and plans of salvation to meet what is the need of their inmost natures while remaining bound to the flesh, the life in the world, and the world itself. All were accommodated to the darkness of this world and feared the prospect of leaving it, not knowing what might follow. The sole will of God, therefore, is that all the potential children in the world desire to leave the world and come to Him. God has no goals or purpose for earth, except that it provide, through natural processes, individuals that will be candidates for life in heaven. This is the will of God that is continually done in heaven, but which had not been shared by anyone on earth. God's will, therefore, is for that will to be done on earth as it is in heaven by individuals that learn to love Him and truly desire from the heart to rise to Him, abandoning all carnal, earthly, or worldly attachments and identifications. When that begins to take place, His will is done on earth as it is in heaven, according to the petitions of the Lord's Prayer. Humans who are candidates for the divine childhood are bound to their natural habitat and driven by the inner vacuum of the Spirit to seek to fill it in terms of the things of the flesh in the world. They are totally ignorant of His sole desire for them and even believe that the darkness is light. God's will can never be done on earth until they learn the truth of the grand destiny their Creator has ordained for them and then freely choose, out of their own heart's desire, to raise and go to God, just like the prodigal son did in his parable. But it is imperative that we choose to go ourselves. It is for this reason that God has created the world, that whosoever will may choose to go to Him from the world and be in His glory, not because they have to be there, but only because they have chosen to be there. Humans had no way of knowing this will of God. God began the process of informing them by first selecting a people that, as a people, were to be bearers of this knowledge. From among these, He chose certain ones, called prophets, to whom He began slowly to reveal His will. Centuries passed, however, and no one accurately defined His will, and so no one was doing His will on earth as it was in heaven. Finally, as a last and final effort, He begot a son and sent him, His only begotten, into the world to teach man what He wanted. It would not be enough simply to teach them, however, for His will was so far from human conception as to render them blind, utterly blind, to the truth. Therefore, it was also necessary for the teacher to illustrate by his personal example in a most public and dramatic manner the meaning of God's will, and to become an example by being the first person on earth to do God's will, on earth as it is in heaven. Jesus became that person, charged by God with the supreme responsibility for making God's will fully known to earth. He did this by making and teaching disciples and exemplifying God's will by being the first man to perform it on earth as it is in heaven, where He submitted to the terrible death of crucifixion. He made the message and meaning of God's will unmistakable when He rose up from the tomb and at last ascended in their sight to God. Before ascending, Jesus charged them with the same responsibility God had laid upon Him, to teach and to manifest the will of God on earth just as He had done. It is by their faithfulness that the truth continued to be preserved and displayed before men in the canonical Gospels. This truth is summarized in all four canonical Gospels as the saying, "For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, and whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it." If we choose well in selecting this as the basic purpose of Jesus' mission to earth, then we will find that all other statements of purpose are secondary to this. And so, we now turn to look at the secondary statements of purpose. Jesus came, therefore, to save the world, to preach the kingdom of God, to call sinners to repentance, for judgment, in order that those not seeing may see, those seeing may become blind, to give His life a ransom for many, and to be a witness to the truth. Jesus came, therefore, to save the world. If Jesus' mission was portrayed correctly earlier, then we can understand that earth was wholly lost because not a single person had loved God so much as to want to rise to Him. Only when people began to fulfill His purpose for creating the world could the entire enterprise be redeemed. The world was lost, and Jesus came to save it by teaching and doing God's will on earth. This purpose is secondary to the aim of doing God's will on earth, as it expresses the result of having done God's will on earth as it is in heaven. Jesus came to preach the kingdom of God. Every kingdom exists and endures while it responds to the rule of the king. A king cannot rule where his subjects don't listen to him, after all. Therefore, Jesus preached the gospel of the kingdom, which was simply that the kingdom of God was soon to come to earth. The two ideas, the coming of the kingdom and the doing of the will of God, the king, are at the top of the Lord's Prayer. There is little difference in the ranking of this and number 4, but it is evident that the kingdom of God has not come until His will has been done on earth. Therefore, the doing of God's will remains primary. For this reason, we can say that the first one to do the will of God on earth also established His kingdom on earth with the same event, the yielding up of his life on the cross. Jesus came to call sinners to repentance. Humans have, in general, understood sin as the transgression of the law of God. Moses delivered the law, and to transgress the law of Moses is to sin. We even find support for this definition on other non-gospel writings of the New Testament, such as 1 John 3:4. Now that we know and understand the will of God, we can understand that sin is much deeper than that. Transgressing the law is a sin, but that does not suffice to define sin in its most basic and primary form, which is to transgress the will of God. And that will is succinctly stated in Jesus' statement, "For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, but whosoever shall save his life for my sake and the gospel's, the same shall save it." It is the love of life in this world that is the primary sin, and all others proceed from that. The will of God is that one hates his life in this world and desires only to go to him. Should one continue to love life in this world, which is separate from God, one is committing the most fundamental sins, for one's entire life is sin. In calling sinners to repentance, Jesus is calling us to repent of the love of life in this world and do God's will on earth as he himself did it. This statement of purpose is therefore secondary. It is the condition sinners must meet if they are to do God's will on earth as it is in heaven. Jesus came to do the will of the Father. This is our primary purpose, which we left here just so we don't have people wondering why we skipped over number 4. Jesus came for judgment in order that those not seeing may see, those seeing may become blind. The context in John 9 is the healing on the Sabbath of a man born blind. Jesus prefaced this miracle by saying that he is the light of the world while he is in the world. The man born blind, not seeing, believed in him. The Pharisees became involved because Jesus had done this work on the Sabbath, and they questioned the man born blind about Jesus' identity. The man said that Jesus was a prophet, and so the Pharisees immediately cast him out of the synagogue. Jesus, upon learning about it, found the man and affirmed that man's faith in Jesus as being a prophet from God. There were Pharisees lurking about, listening, and heard him say, "For judgment I am come into this world, that they which see not might see, and that they which see might be made blind." And some of the Pharisees which were with him heard these words, and said unto him, "Are we blind also?" Jesus said unto them, "If ye were blind, ye would have no sin. But now ye say we see, therefore your sin remaineth." There is a subtle interplay of meaning between the physical and spiritual sight and physical and spiritual blindness. The man was born physically blind, and by becoming sighted, he saw not only the light of this world, but also the spiritual light that was in Jesus, who is the light of the world. For him, it was a double meaning of double blindness. The Pharisees, physically sighted but spiritually blind, believed also that they were spiritually sighted. This statement of purpose expresses a result of Jesus' mission, and not its purpose. He did not come to judge the world, and was not judging them. They were nonetheless occupying the ground of those that would be judged at the last day, because they said, "We see," while being spiritually blind. Jesus came to give his life a ransom for many. When God sent Jesus to earth, Satan exercised all authority over the nations of the world, even all men. We conceive of the view from heaven prior to sending his Son to redeem men from the world. Those few that would go on to become children of God were in bondage to Satan, to darkness, and to death. Their deliverance required that a child of God come into the world and yield his life to the agents of Satan, thereby leading those willing ones back home to the Father. His crucifixion therefore served as a ransom paid to Satan for the rescue of the children of God. It was a trap for Satan, by which he was overcome in the process of collecting his ransom and lost all of his authority. The only will of God is to have his lost children come home. That Jesus paid a price to that end is therefore secondary to God's will. Jesus came to be a witness to the truth. Pontius Pilate, governor of Judea and Jerusalem, must have been irritated by the Jews because they brought Jesus before him so early in the morning. He sensed that Jesus was not a threat to Rome, but pursued this issue by asking Jesus if he were a king and therefore a threat to Roman authority. Jesus responded by saying, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, then would my servants fight, that I should not be delivered to the Jews, but now is my kingdom not from hence. Thou sayest that I am a king. To this end was I born, and for this cause came I into the world, that I should bear witness unto the truth. Everyone that is of the truth heareth my voice." Jesus essentially said that he came into the world to be a witness to the truth, and only those hearing the truth hear his voice. This is why Pilate said, "What is truth?" before going to offer the Jews the choice of releasing either Jesus or Barabbas. When they chose Barabbas, the governor reluctantly delivered Jesus to be crucified. Jesus came into the world to be a witness to the truth in every way, and in particular by means of his death, so as to lead those that are of the truth to God, which is God's will. Jesus came also to fulfill the prophecy of Isaiah 61:1-2. Earlier, we set this purpose aside. Let us look at it now. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. Here, we see a lot of purposes that Jesus came, but all relate to the last purpose, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. It's a reference to Isaiah 61:1 and 2, which in turn refers to the year Jubilee. All of these purposes are secondary to doing the will of God, for they represent consequences of his work on earth, not the ultimate reason for his coming. Yes, Jesus preached the gospel to the poor, healed people, preached deliverance to captives, and gave sight to the blind. His mission would have been wonderful if that were all he came and did, but doing only these things would not have led the children of God back to God. Therefore, none of these purposes are primary, nor is the entire prophecy taken as a unit. Along with stating why he came, or was sent into the world, Jesus also stated some reasons why he did not come. Jesus came not to judge the world, not to call the righteous to repentance, not to do his own will, not to bring peace on earth, and not to be served. Jesus came not to judge the world. It was out of love for the world that God sent him into the world. Therefore, he did not send him to judge anyone. The promise at the time, and even now, is that all that believe in him should not perish. This is the time for rescuing the perishing in consequence of his first appearance in the world. Those that have not believed will be judged on the last day. His coming was for judgment's sake, but not to judge. And if any man hear my words and believe not, I judge him not. For I came not to judge the world, but to save the world. He that rejecteth me and receiveth not my words hath one that judge him. The word that I have spoken, the same shall judge him in the last day. Jesus came not to call the righteous to repentance. These are the righteous in the sight of God, and they have no need for repentance. The unjust are the sinners, and these included the Pharisees to whom Jesus was addressing. They trusted in their sacrifices as rendering them just, and thought of the tax collectors and others as sinners. Therefore, Jesus included them in the category of sinners, explaining that God desires mercy and not sacrifices. Jesus came not to do his own will. He entered into his mission by declaring whose will he came to perform, the primary statement of purpose. Shortly before dying, Jesus was withdrawn from them about a stone's cast and kneeled down and prayed, saying, Father, if thou be willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. Jesus came not to bring peace on earth. He did not want to purge earth of war or to do anything that would impose change on earth. Therefore, he did not and does not pray for the world. Nor should we utter similar prayers, such as a prayer for world peace that he has not specifically imposed on the world. Jesus said, I pray for them, I pray not for the world, but for them which thou hast given me, for they are thine. It isn't that Jesus doesn't want peace for all men, it is that men in general love life in this world and will fight to glorify and defend that life. It is pointless to pray for what is not to be. When men pray for peace on earth, they expose their ignorance of the word and their love of life in the world. Jesus came not to be served. The sons of Zebedee petitioned Jesus to give them the chief places of authority in his kingdom, on the right and left hands of the king. The 10 other apostles were very indignant when they heard of this request by James and John, for they also hoped to have appointments to high office in the kingdom. The further significance of this request comes from understanding that, at this point, the 12 all expected Jesus, as the Messiah, to reinstate the reign of David over Israel and rule from Jerusalem. This notion would not be dispelled until all the disciples witnessed the resurrection and came to understand that the kingdom of God was not of this world. If they were to hold high offices in the age to come, it must be by following the example of their Lord, Jesus. He did not come to rule earth from a Jerusalem throne. He teaches instead that the humble in this world are blessed, for they will rule in the eternal kingdom from heaven. Jesus' mission was to do the will of God on earth as it is in heaven. For I came down from heaven, not to do my own will, but the will of him that sent me. And this is the Father's will with that sent me, that of all which he hath given me I should lose nothing, but should raise it up again at the last day. And this is the will of him that sent me, that everyone the which seeth the Son, and believeth on him, may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up at the last day. Now that we know the prime purpose for Jesus' mission, we can also know why Jesus leaves believers here, rather than calling us home as soon as we are born again. He said, Peace be unto you, as my Father hath sent me, even so send I you.